Welcome, everybody. This is Microsoft 365 and Power Platform, a weekly community call with Microsoft presenters and Microsoft speakers. So this call is really for the Microsoft people to showcase the stuff what they built and explain how their designs and features and capabilities are intended to be used. So really hearing from the people who actually created the capabilities, like today. As an example, Cathy Dew is kind of talking about the SharePoint Brand Center and theming and all of that. And she's been PMing and owning that feature for quite a few years. So I will let her to talk about all of that history as well as we get started on things. Now, quickly recapping the agenda. So we're going to go through again a similar set of all of the links and assets which are available for you to get started on the Microsoft 365 Power Platform. That is highly intentional. There's always new people in this course. So we want everybody to be on the same line and not make that assumption that everybody already knows all of this stuff. That is not true. It's okay always to come as a new person. We'll guide you through on this journey. And we really, really want to every single new person to be to feel welcome as we get started on this journey. Now, we also go through the latest news, and then we go to the crew photo and in together mode with all of you, and that is the section where you can definitely enable your camera, and we'll get a nice together mode picture with you. You can keep the camera on throughout the call as well, no worries on that. But then the real stars of today are Cathy Dew, talking about the latest features within the SharePoint Brand Center, really, really cool capability from end users, for administrators, for developers. There's a lot of aspects what this one is actually touching, so it's really cool to get covered. And also Ayça and Bob is going to talk about introduction to building Microsoft 365 Copilot agents. So what on earth are those agents all about? Or maybe they are double agents. Let's see how it goes. Hopefully they're not double agents anyway. Now let's actually go through the typical set of slides or links and slides as well. So we do have a lot of assets for you to get started on the Microsoft Cloud. So we have our YouTube channel where we publish at least one video every single day. And we've been pretty consistently actually publishing roughly 12 to 15 videos every single week. So there's a lot of new content getting published over there. And that's intentional. So we want to make sure that you have a lot of guidance and videos so you can actually determine which of those are relevant for you. And then you watch them or catch up what has happened within the community calls as an example. All of these community calls are getting published within that channel. All of the demos are getting also published within that channel as well. So easier way to stay up to date on what's happening. We also have our LinkedIn page and the group for discussions and updates to stay up to date on LinkedIn. Unfortunately, Twitter has been a bit slowing down, Twitter or X or whatever we call it nowadays. But LinkedIn is growing up from a popularity perspective. So please use LinkedIn, LinkedIn if you want to stay up to date on what's happening within the community. A lot of open source assets, but as it might be a bit difficult to find the relevant sample for you from the hundreds and hundreds of repos what we have in the GitHub, we also have these really cool sample galleries, which will help it make it super easy to find the relevant sample for you. All of these samples provided by Microsoft and community from one centralized location, AKMS Community Samples. We're going to talk about that one in a second as well. A lot of URLs, but only one URL to remember, which is AKMS/community/home. And from there, you can find all of the relevant samples. Now, you are in a community call, so you're kind of familiar with these community calls, and there's a lot of them. We execute at least 2 community calls every single week, typically, except the holiday season and summertime, when there's at least 1 community call every single week. That is a lot of content. You don't have to be in all of these. Have a look on the agendas in advance to decide which of those calls you actually want to be, because you can always check the recording afterwards. But today, we are at the weekly with Microsoft Speakers call, 8 a.m. every single Tuesday, Pacific time. So we focused on Microsoft 365 or Power Platform topics, depending on the speakers, depending on our feature crews, how they're signing up for the call to demonstrate the art of possible. On top of that, we have the Power Platform monthly community call and then the Office Add-ins monthly community call. And then on 7 a.m. Thursdays, we either have the Microsoft 365 Power Platform community call or Viva Connection SharePoint Framework community call. That is 7 a.m. Pacific time. That's 10 a.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Central European time, and so on, if I calculate quickly all of the time zones correctly. Except, by the way, a bit of a warning, next week is the weird time of the year when US moves forward on away from summertime. Europe is still in the summertime, so depending on where you are, you might be impacted of that one. And next week, I think the Europe will be impacted, so the calls will be 1 hour earlier. So that's a good heads up for 1 week only. and then Europe moves to the winter time, so to say, or normal time, whatever, the time zones are so difficult. Daylight away from the daylight saving times, and there 2 weeks from now, we'll be back on the normal schedule. Anyway, if you have downloaded the recurrent invites, those will be aligned automatically within your calendar, so you can actually see which time the calls is actually happening. Also, you can double check the agenda and the details at the meetup service. Now, for a lot of these calls, we do welcome community demos. Really doesn't have to be rocket science. We were just talking about this one before we started recording. A lot of people think that they can only sign up when it's a rocket science, complicated, open source sample demo. And the answer is no. The most popular and most useful demos are getting started demos. How to get started on doing something, how to get started on using a product, how you get started on using Copilot Studio and building something, and all of that stuff. Every single one of us approach these things differently. Even though somebody has maybe done a demo on something, it doesn't mean that you wouldn't be able to do it, because you have something extra to give on that storyline as well. So please sign up at the AKMS Community Request Demo. We will then schedule you based on the demo content and the planned material, what you're planning to show, on the right call within the future. Now, getting started on Microsoft Cloud, we do have our Microsoft 365 Developer Program. It is no longer available for every single person free within the world. Unfortunately, as we did that in the past, there was a malicious people, bad people. They always come and start behaving badly. So therefore, that program right now is limited for those who are part of the partner programs in Microsoft and those who are part of who have a Visual Studio subscription, and they can sign up and continue using that program. There are ongoing discussions still on how else we can provide a developer tenants more efficiently for everybody, but no news on there. We do have a lot of learning material available for Microsoft 365 and Power Platform, depending on which area you're looking into. But if you go to the learn portals, you can see a lot of free learning materials for all of the different things which you can invent on. Now, talking about the tenant, now, if you do not qualify for getting a free tenant right now, currently, you can actually get a tenant pretty free at $72 in a year. Now, if you're employed, if you're a developer, if you're building stuff, $72 in a year, it's not a massive cost, but we do understand that that is a certain amount of money. The good thing about getting this one and following up on this option is that there's no renewal policy. As long as you keep on paying $72 in a year, all of that will get renewed automatically. So nobody can take that tenant away from you. So super, super useful thing to consider if you want to go to this path for getting the tenant, if you don't qualify for the free tenant right now. Now, we do have different shows available for Microsoft 365 Power Platform and a few other shows. We should actually probably update the slides already. The PMP Weekly continued 6 years. Unfortunately, the last episode on that one was aired at 17th of September. Have a look on that one. Feedback is always welcome. On that one, I'm looking into restarting another show in a bit not in the same frequency. Doing a one show every single week is actually quite a lot of time, so we needed to adjust that a bit. Mondays at Microsoft is happening bi-weekly with Caruana and Heather. Great option to stay up to date on what's happening in Microsoft 365. And then there's the Microsoft 365 Developer Podcast, which is supposed to have new episodes coming up sooner or later. Looking forward on those as well. Now, coming back on the samples we mentioned then, we do have more than 2,100 samples available at the AKMS Community Samples. We're just looking into the samples earlier today with some of the virtual team members. We are actually missing quite a few samples still, so we're closer to 2,300, I think, samples. So we're adding more repos, more organizations involved on finding this, surfacing their samples from this one centralized location, which is super, super cool. You can go here, you can filter based on products, you can based on the search criteria or based on the user who created the sample, you can find the relevant sample for you. And all of the samples are using MIT license, which means that you can download that, you can adjust that, you can learn from that, you can even potentially repackage that and push it in store and hopefully make billions and billions and billions of money. Who knows? But at least it's there for inspiration for you to get started on your journey within the Microsoft Cloud. Now, as you find a sample, if you're not super experienced on GitHub and all of this stuff, you might be wondering, okay, so here's the sample. What do I do now? I don't know how this GitHub works. What do I do now? Help me. We can help you. We do have our Sharing is Caring initiative, and we have David Warner from LA Studios jumping in on explaining what this is all about.
LA taking over. Thank you, Vesa. And holy cow. Holy cow, everybody. Yes, all those samples, MIT licensed. Now, Vesa, does that mean that I can tell people I was educated at MIT now once I've done those samples? You, I mean,
yes,
tell anybody
yes,
you want.
Exactly.
Yes, awesome. Woohoo. Yes. Yeah. All right. What is Sharing is Caring, everybody? It is a program that provides hands-on guidance. And what does that mean? It means we are going to join a live Teams call together, and we're going to learn how to do stuff. And one of those things is interacting with GitHub. What is a pull request? We'll find out. What is a fork? We're going to show you. What is a community contribution? You're going to do one. And it's a safe space, meaning no recording. Ask any and all questions free of worry. Is it going to be recorded that I don't know how to do something? We all don't know how to do stuff, everybody. That's how we learn. So be on the lookout. Hugo and I are up in Minnesota this weekend. We're trying to get everything scheduled before then. It just didn't work. So we're getting it set up for November. Be on the lookout for that. And as Vesa said, we're looking to expand some samples. And, you know, once you do contribute, by the way, keep an eye out at ak.ms/sharingiscaring for that schedule. And then once you do contribute, you're going to get recognized as long as you opt into our recognition program, because that is where we have partnered with Credly and that we have those official and accredited badges. We've got all kinds of fresh ones here. We're still in October for a few more days. So you've got Hacktoberfest. You've got Promptober. I was processing badges just before this call, so we got lots of cool ones to give out. We got the Refresh Rangers Prompt Pro. We're going to bring back the Slice of Samples in the Season of Getting. So get involved. It's a great time. Wonderful way to show that you are making a real difference in the community. Show your clients, show your bosses, show your family. They're going to be proud of you. We know we are. So absolutely free. We cover the cost. ak.ms/community/recognition. Get your name put in there. We'll track you. No need to put it in more than once unless you've changed some information. And we'll reward you with the badge. That's it. Back to you in the Finland studios.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you, LA and Helsinki taking over. Now, quick recap on all of the different events which are coming up. So first of all, TechCon 365 Dallas event is coming up in November 11th to 15th. SARLDC were already earlier this year. Awesome, awesome events. Don't miss out on that option if you're that side of the pond. Now, we have also the Ignite, Microsoft hosted Ignite conference coming up. The in-person experience in Chicago is already sold out, but this is actually free online as well. So you can only go to the, if you go to the ignitemicrosoft.com, you can register and then you can see all of the different sessions which are available and build your own session schedule. Definitely recommended. There's a lot of interesting announcement coming up on that conference as well. Now, after that, in December, for 2nd to 5th of December, we have the European SharePoint conference happening at Stockholm. It is actually European Azure, Microsoft 365 and so on conference. So it's much, much, much broader, wider than just about SharePoint. They just chose to use the SharePoint Europe as the name for their conference, which is really descriptive as well. Now, later on next year, in May 2025, we have the European Collaboration Summit happening together with European AI and Cloud Summit and European Biz App Summit. So there's a one big conference happening at the same time at the Düsseldorf in 26th to 28th of May. An estimated attendance will be roughly 3,000 attendees. Really, really cool setup as well. The venue looks really, really nice and it works really, really well as well. I've been there a few times personally as well. On top of this, there's a lot of community hosted events all around the world. Some of these are in person, some of them are online, some of them are paid, some of them are free. So depending on an event, depending on where it is, have a look on the details at communitydays.org and join and meet other people within the community. Great opportunities to catching up and discussing, for example, your experiences of building stuff for Microsoft Cloud with Microsoft people and also other people in the community. Now, on the news side this week, relatively quiet news week. A lot of products didn't have actually any news last week, but of course, there's some announcements, always new stuff for Copilot, and always new stuff for Teams, and always new stuff for Power Platform. So a lot of cool stuff over there, and David just pasted in the news in the chat, and you can always check the news also from the video notes if you're watching this recording afterwards. Now, before we go to the keto mode and doing pictures, just a quick recap also on Copilot prompts. This is one of our new initiatives, collecting examples how the Copilot can be used and how it works with a prompt. So one way of contributing for the community is to build your own Copilot prompts and contributing that with the community. Now, this week, the weekly prompt of the week is coming from Peter Paul Krishner, which is around sorting emails by priority and top priority and mark them and group them and all of that stuff. I was watching this prompt earlier today, for example, categorize emails by action with immediate action needed for replies to my emails, blah, 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 blah. The coolest thing about this one is that what if we would, at least in my case, I get a lot of emails every single night when I'm sleeping. I would love to have a scheduled agent which will actually aggregate my emails for every single morning in a list and flag those in a which are most important and with the deep links and everything else. And that is actually possible. You can do that. You can do scheduled events and scheduled agents nowadays within Copilot. So there's a lot of interesting opportunities there. Now, before we go to the actual stars of today, starting with Cathy, we have the picture time. So we can actually go to a, if you enable the camera, we'll grab a GIF animation with every attendee in the call. I will actually change the scene. I will risk it. It should be working now fine. I want to do the auditorium. That's a much nicer way of doing that. I can see Elliot on the back row, a lot of familiar faces. Cathy in the second row. Todd is already waving hands, showing the example. Let's wait a few more seconds. We have 50 seats in the room. Camtasia is already ready to go. I'm not yet recording. Few more seats, or are we hitting the maximum? I guess we are hitting the maximum pretty soon. So let me put the recording on, and let's do some hand waving, everybody. 3, 2, 1, hand wave and smile. Thank you for joining. Awesome to have you on a call. Great. Great to see the smiles always on here. We are a community. Thank you for being part of the community. We really, truly appreciate you being here. Thanks, everybody. We'll share that in a social media after the call. Cool. That's it for the Together What picture. Let's move on to the actual stars of the day. So we'll start with Cathy, and then we go to Ayça Bast and Bob German after that. But Cathy, I can see you on the call. We checked the audio already.
Ready? I'm going to take over. Yep. Sure.
Yep, definitely. Yep.
Fantastic. So today we're going to chat a little bit about the SharePoint Brand Center and all of the latest updates that have come into the SharePoint Brand Center, and then the latest set of updates for site branding, which are coming into your tenants now. So we'll start out just quickly, run through the Brand Center. The Brand Center has moved into GA. It is now 100% fully GA. Again, a quick reminder for the SharePoint Brand Center, this does require an initial tenant admin setup to enable the Brand Center. And then once you have that, you go into the SharePoint site that has been designated as the Brand Center. Many different ways that that can happen. There's kind of three different scenarios that the admin will get walked through to pick depending on how your tenant is set up. Once you have that, site owners of the particular site will become become able to access the Brand Center. So you'll be able to enter that directly with a URL or by going to the settings gear and then navigating to the Brand Center. In the Brand Center, as it moved into GA, and it's always a fun demo god happening thing where it just doesn't always load up because my computer goes, oh, you want a screen share? But when you load up the Brand Center, what you'll notice is you have brand fonts, and then you'll have a new section for colors. And then as a part of SharePoint and Viva Connections, you have our existing font packages that we released earlier this year. And then now we've added the ability for themes here. So just to highlight the quick changes here into the Brand Center, we've added more support across SharePoint web parts for custom fonts, and then we've introduced brand colors and themes. So when you come in, you'll be able to set up your reusable set of colors. So for your organization, maybe you have a set of colors that are standardized, and you can enter those and create that list. And then when you're coming in and you're creating your themes, you are able to pick from those colors. So any colors that's a part of that library library, or you can create a custom color just for that theme. So you could go through and pick any of those colors that you set up and go through and create your themes really quickly here. And so as you go through, you can easily create, pick, we're just going to go through. And so it gives us that accessibility checker here to check our color contrast, which is always something we're paying attention to. And then we can go ahead and when we get to this section, we can actually preview it on SharePoint so we can see what that new theme will look like, what it changes in our SharePoint sites, and also for Viva Connections. We can simply name it here, and then once we name it, it will then appear into the SharePoint Brand Center here, which then makes it available in Change the Look in our sites. So very similarly with font packages, you're setting those up, creating those from the fonts that you've uploaded into the Brand Center app, and then making them available for your organization through Change the Look, making it easy for site owners to be able to pick from that official branding that you've created and set up. So the next big piece of this is taking it a little bit further. So we come in here, and first we're going to go in and we're going to look at Change the Look just to see where those brand items that we set up before. So there's those two that I have set up and made available. These are currently visible in the Brand Center app. So that's why only two of the three show up. One of them is not visible. And you can see that Rella Cloud teal and that sales green being available. But you may notice a new section here, this new section of from this site. So with that, let's talk about what this is. So we are introducing a site branding concept, which will mean that you will be able to create themes and font packages for your individual sites. So site owners will have access to this, and you'll be able to come in. When you come into this experience, you'll see site branding showing up. You'll see themes and font packages. Font packages, a quick note, will be available only if your organization has set up the Brand Center and uploaded custom fonts. A site owner is not able to upload their own font to be utilized as a font package. They're only going to be able to use fonts that are available through the Brand Center. Why did we make this decision? Fonts are code, right? And so they can contain malicious items. So we are restricting who can upload and manage those fonts that will be available to the Brand Center. But once you have fonts uploaded, you will be able to do this. Also to note, this does not change how hubs and hub branding works. So in a site associated to a hub, the branding is inherited from that hub. So at that hub root level, the main site that is designated as a hub, you would still be able to go in and create a theme and a font package and apply it. But at the associated site level, you would not be able to do that and create a theme and apply it to your site. So in here, you'll see that. So let's go through quickly and create a new theme. So we'll come in, and again, you see that same theme creation experience you saw in the Brand Center, where I have that official color list. So if I wanted to create just a different theme from a new color that maybe is not available, but maybe I want to create my own and I want to have it really be customized. The holidays are coming up, so maybe we want to do a little bit more of kind of a fall theme here, so we can go through and pick in a little bit more of a fall leaf color, you know, and have this come through. And we could go in and say, hey, I want this to be true black. I want my text to be true black. So we could go in and create that. We could even go in and create that background color, right? So maybe it's, like I said, fall coming up. Maybe I want kind of a little bit of a yellow tint. Go through and set that up. Oh my goodness, but look what happened. When I was doing that, it's now told me that there are accessibility issues here. So I will want to go ahead and resolve that. So as I'm creating it, it's just paying attention to what it is. It's giving me that warning so I can come in and I can then edit that further to make this work a little bit better for me. So I can come in and pick a lighter color of that yellow to make that background, right? So I can just go in and adjust this. And once I do that, it's going to resolve that accessibility issue. We have the dark theme here. So if you were to make that background color a dark color, say have it be black or a very dark color and your text color to be white, you're going to designate that as a dark theme by using this toggle here, which will help the system understand where to automatically change font colors. And then you'll be able to pick an accent color. And it is a great scavenger hunt challenge if you're using the accent color to try to find exactly where the accent color is used. But you can go ahead and set that. Where that does show up is in your change the look experience. You'll be able to see that. So here we can go through, we can preview this. And one thing you'll notice here, it's different from the Brand Center. I'm in a SharePoint site. This site is not designated as the home site. So in my preview here in site branding, I'm only seeing UI elements and SharePoint as my preview options. So I don't get to see that Viva Connections preview because this is not a Viva Connections connected site. So I could flip over and see how that new theme is going to apply to my SharePoint site. And I can scroll down and kind of look at it and see if I like it. And if I do, I'm going to go ahead and name that theme. So we'll go ahead and name the theme. And then once I do, it shows up here into site branding. And then I simply go back into my site itself. And then when I go to change the look, that branding will be there for me to pick and apply to my site. So I can go into change the look. And then now when I go to theme, I'll have that falling leaves theme that we just created in our site branding experience to be available. And then I can apply that to my site. So really easy for site owners to now customize. They still have every option defined through the Brand Center for that official organization branding they have as they're creating their custom themes and font packages for their sites. They have your brand colors set up as the first options for them to pick from so that they can pick those colors to create the theme when they have those fonts to pick from when creating their font packages. But you can apply this. So you can really think about all of those sites where people want to have that holiday party or that special initiative and really being able to highlight that and create a theme specifically for that or being able to change them out. Also gives us a lot of fun here with the Brand Center and finally bringing the theme creation experience out of a code experience and a PowerShell install experience into a really simple to use visual experience to build that out. So we're really excited for that, and there's more coming here for site branding. As you know, you may have visited a site that you just really love the branding for, and maybe you want to use that on your own site. So be looking ahead for even more coming to the Brand Center and into the site branding experiences as we continue to make it easier and easier for you to customize your sites and make them look beautiful. Okay, Ayça, I think that gets me.
Yeah. Now, don't stop sharing. Don't stop sharing. I want to ask two questions for the record. Sure. Question number one: can we plug the option for people to create their own themes? That was a question in a chat, so that the brands that people might be a bit hesitant for allowing that. So, is there a switch somewhere to disable?
So, there's not a switch. So, site branding. Think of this just like you're creating, you know, Word, PowerPoint, everything. Anyone can customize what they want. Now, we do encourage people, if you have that, remember, site branding is only accessible by site owners. So, making sure that you are using your permissions groups appropriately, that you're training out users as to what they should and shouldn't do. Now, a lot of people also include branding as a part of a site template. So you're setting that default for them so that they don't have to think about it. And many people will never even visit Change the Look to make a change there or find that site branding experience. And so it's really about making sure our permissions are being utilized correctly for site owners and that we are sending out the proper user training for what should and should not allow you to go change your branding.
And then one more kind of a starting question. So where did we find the Brand Central? How do we find the Brand Central in a clean SharePoint? What do I need to do that I can find Brand Central?
Yeah, so in a tenant, so there's three ways that, like I said, that it can show up. If your organization was already using organization asset libraries, the site that was designated for those organization asset libraries is where your brand center will show up. And so you can easily go to that site if you've used it in the past. If you're an admin, the admin has a quick place through the Microsoft 365 Admin Center to get all of the URLs for the Brand Center site, as well as directly into that app. But the quickest way to know is if you've already been using organization asset libraries in your tenant, that is the site that your Brand Center is built on. If you are not, we start, and you may see that, have seen that in the site, but we start with the recommendation that the name of that site be Brand Guide. So if you've never used organization asset libraries before in your organization, the prompted easy fill-in default name that we set up, of course it's customizable by the admin, is Brand Guide. So you can always look for that. And we have a great Brand Central site template that you can apply to that site to have a great starting point for building out how you want to use your Brand Center site itself, if you so desire.
Excellent. And then kind of a just an additional note on this one, if you are building custom experiences with SPFX, we do have guidance on how to tap into the custom theming and fonts and all of that within the documentation. I just put the link in the chat as well on that guidance. But thank you, Cathy.
I actually believe our latest Message Center post went out yesterday, I believe. So we are also adding in additional support with PowerShell and with SiteScript actions for custom fonts as well. So a lot of things happening, a lot coming through for the Brand Center, and a lot more exciting things coming in the future.
Yeah. Thank you, Cathy. Awesome stuff. Awesome stuff to see this moving. And I know that there's a lot of exciting stuff on this area coming in the future as well. So can't wait to get you back on the show. Now, thank you, Cathy, on that one. Then let's move into Bob and Ayça, or Ayça and Bob. I think Bob starts, and then we move to Ayça for demo. Or how did we do that, Bob? It doesn't really matter, if I understood correctly.
We'll see how this is going to go. You've heard of just-in-time compiling or just-in-time inventory. Ayça is doing a just-in-time presentation. She had a bit of a crisis thing. I don't think serious, but she had to run to the airport, and I think she's back and typing right now. So I'm going to kick it off, and then when she pops in, I will let her take over her part. I'm here. Please go ahead and hand over in CEO. Okay, got it. So let me cut to the chase, because we're in the second slot. People might trail off. If there's one thing I want people to take from this presentation, it's to announce that we have a Copilot Camp live stream. So Copilot Developer Camp is our new hands-on virtual workshop, but it's not all virtual. For developing Copilot agents, and we want to invite everyone, and please spread the word on this, to join us on November 7th from 9 to 10:30 a.m. Pacific for a live cast. And we're going to have all kinds of interviews and other special features in that you won't see anywhere else. So please don't miss that. So with that said, let me go ahead and share my screen. And we can dig into today's presentation. So we're going to talk today very briefly about building Microsoft 365 Copilot agents. And if you might say, well, I've been hearing all this agent stuff. What is this agent thing? And, you know, it doesn't have anything to do with the Matrix or people wearing trench coats and any of that stuff. It's really about having an agent that acts on your behalf inside of Copilot and having a more tailored experience, so that instead of trying to explain to Copilot exactly what do I mean, maybe there's an agent that is really, really good at HR requests or some other specific thing. And that's what you're going to learn here to build. So got the link right there for the announcement on September 16th of the new Copilot agents by Satya Nadella. So you probably know what Microsoft 365 Copilot is. It's basically the application of AI or the bringing of AI into Microsoft 365, where you have access to all the content that you've created there. And the new thing here is this idea of agents, which makes it quite a bit more usable. So what you're seeing is the Copilot user interface, and I would point out that there's a name for this. It's called BizChat. It's a special chat experience that is built into Teams, Microsoft 365 app, which is office.com, and it's going to show up in more and more places. So this is, that's just vocabulary. There's a panel opener slider on the right. You open that up and you get to see your agents. Some of the agents are going to be from Microsoft, like the visual creator, for instance. Some of them could come from you. Some of them could come from third parties. You could buy them in the store. The idea is that they're refined experiences. So instead of talking to, imagine walking into a building and talking to the person at the front desk and assuming that they know everything in the company. That's kind of a lot to ask. And you're going to have to, even if they know everything, you're going to have to explain what you're asking for in a fair amount of detail. If you ask about a project, what kind of project, right? If you have a an agent, it can be more specialized. Users are used to going to expert humans, so this is sort of the same thing. You're finding an expert agent who can help you with whatever it is that you need to do. We have two experiences. One is called the immersive experience, and this is where it takes over BizChat. So you get a branding for your agent. You get some prompt starters and things like that. And so the user just is completely talking to your agent. But we've now added something called the in-context experience, where you can mention agents, potentially bringing in more than one, or bringing them into a group chat or a meeting where there's multiple humans. And that agent will then interact inside of the in the context of whatever else it was that you were doing. So pretty cool stuff. So why would you want an agent, right? Well, as I mentioned, it's really all about tailoring Copilot for a specific use case within your enterprise or organization. Everybody's HR agent might be a little different because we all have different policies in different geographies, right? You might have an IT agent or a legal agent or a tutor, right? You can think the sky's the limit, and we have a new repository now for community samples that are going to include these agents. So I'll drop that link right here. Already we're seeing a bunch of them turn up, and I've got my work cut out for me on Thursday to announce all the new declarative agents and agents that are inside that repo. Anyway, let's look at the options for what you have available to you in agents. So you may have seen this slide before. This goes all the way back to last year's Ignite, and Donna Sarkar, unforgettable presenter, right? She presented adopt, extend, and build. So the idea is you can adopt Copilot just like it is. And if you know, and the prompt samples repo, I don't have the link handy, is a great way to learn how to adopt it better and get ideas from other users. And maybe someone can drop the repo in there for where you can submit your favorite Copilot. Say, thank you so much, David. Community prompts, right? Or find prompts from other people and get inspiration. I never thought of using Copilot like that, right? If you want to build agents, you've got two choices. You could have declarative agents or custom engine agents. And the goal of today's short presentation is just going to be really to show you the difference between those. And then next week, I'm going to go deeper on declarative. And I've already teased that in a few of these sessions, so we're going to go a little bit deeper. And then the week after that, Ayça is going to do a deep dive on custom engine agents. So what is this, and what's the difference, and how does this relate to me as a developer? Well, there's low-code and pro-code for both types of agents. So you can really kind of choose how you do. You like working in a visual canvas for something for use inside of your tenant, then you probably want Copilot Studio, and you probably should ask someone else because it's not my area of expertise. If you like writing code, maybe even just JSON, it can be pretty simple, and you like using a tool like Visual Studio or Visual Studio Code, you want to work with a team of people, maybe use a source control system, maybe deploy it into a dev tenant and then into separate tenants, multiple feature teams working in parallel, all that kind of stuff. That is where you would choose Teams Toolkit and Visual Studio Code. And that's what we're really going to talk about today. So in any agent, really any kind of workflow presence, you're going to have all these various things, right? You're going to have some kind of workflow instructions to it, natural language. You're going to have things that trigger it, actions it can take, knowledge it can use. There's going to be some kind of an orchestrator and some kind of AI model or large language model at the foundation. The difference between declarative and custom engine agents is really who provides those things. So with declarative agents, Microsoft 365 provides the large language model and the orchestration, and it makes it really easy to tap into your business data that's in OneDrive and SharePoint, graph connectors, etc., and to use what we call custom actions, which are also called plugins, where you're going to call an API to get data from your app. It's retrieval augmented generation, but you don't have to write the code. All you have to do is define your API in detail and explain it through packaging files to Copilot, and it does all the heavy lifting. But maybe you want complete control over your application. In the Copilot Camp Labs, this is the ePath, where you'll call it extend, where you'll extend Copilot with declarative agents. The other option, and we have another whole set of labs courtesy of Ayça Bash, where called the build path, where you build your own agents. So maybe you want to use your own orchestration code. Maybe you want to use your own large language model. Maybe you don't want to take a dependency on Microsoft 365 Copilot and you want to use something else like Azure AI Studio. Well, then you can write your own agent. It will still appear in BizChat. That's not working yet, but that's been announced, and we should be seeing that later this year, this calendar year. And this will allow your custom engine agent, which is basically an AI-driven kind of sophisticated chatbot in BizChat, along with all the other agents. The idea is that the end user doesn't know or care whether the agent is a declarative agent or a custom engine agent. They just know, oh, this is the HR assistant, or this is the IT agent, or this is the security agent. And bang, they can go and ask their question, have their conversation, and take their actions and not really have to worry about the gory details. So here's an example of a declarative agent. And so I've opened up you've probably seen pieces of this demo before. I've got a log file showing at the bottom of the screen in the black region, and then the agents over on the right. I'm going to go ahead and run this locally. So I've got the Trey Genie. Trey Research is a hypothetical consulting company. And so I'm going to be able to talk to it about things that a consultant would need, like what projects am I on, for instance. So I can just ask that question. And if you look down the bottom, you'll see that it's done a call to /API/me. And because this example doesn't have authentication, everybody's going to be Avery Howard. The labs will go a step further and show you how to authenticate the user so you can actually get to the actual person that you're talking to, and everybody gets their own projects. Maybe I want more details, so tell me more about these projects. And what may or may not be evident to the user is that although we got these projects and we've pulled in the details from the API, the declarative agent has also gone out to SharePoint, to our document repository, and pulled in details about these projects from the statement of work documents that's inside of SharePoint. So really powerful. I didn't have to write any of that code. I mean, we wrote the API because it's a sample and we needed something, you know, that made sense. But the reality is, if you've got an API, probably you can reuse all or part of it and build the declarative agent with just declarative code. That's why they call it a declarative agent. If I look at kind of a little architecture, let me do one more prompt just for fun here. I'm just going to say, find my hours spreadsheet in SharePoint and get the hours for Woodgrove and then bill them. And this is when I was doing consulting, this is what I always wanted, is somebody else go and deal with the billing system, right? I really don't. I always had a spreadsheet and I really just don't want to have to, you know, go into the some special application and copy all the numbers over. So it's doing here is it's showing because it's a post request, it's going to update data. We always double check with the user. Is this really what you want me to do? And so, yep, this is what I really want you to do is bill 14 hours. I couldn't remember, but it was in the spreadsheet. And you can see the post down at the bottom that it's actually billed the hours. And here's my proprietary spreadsheet format. Nobody steal this now for recording my hours, right? But you can see that the 14 hours came from there. So the architecture is pretty simple. The bright colored parts are the parts that you get with Microsoft 365 Copilot. And all you have to supply is the instructions, capabilities. You can point it to SharePoint, OneDrive, graph connectors, web content. More is coming. Watch this space at Ignite. And then if you add an API, you're actually adding what we call actions, which requires an API plugin file that basically is a Swagger file with some more details to tell Copilot exactly how to call that API on the user's behalf. And so that's about it. Now, suppose you wanted to build a completely custom engine agent. You would probably meditate real hard and pray to the demo gods and goddesses, and then Ayça would pop in from nowhere and show how to build a custom engine agent. Let's see if it works.
And thanks, Bob, for the great intro for Copilot Agents. And we have a lot more to share, and we'll try to make it quick. But as Bob mentioned at the beginning, we are here in the community calls for 3 weeks back to back. So if you want to dive in more into declarative agents, custom engine agents, continue joining in the series and you'll learn more about it. Okay, so we learned all about declarative agents from Bob. And
okay, your screen stopped sharing, by the way, just FYI, sorry.
Oh, really? Let me try again. Thanks for letting me know. Okay. Let's try again and pray the demo gods. Oh, it moved as well. Wait.
You're good.
Someone is controlling my screen. Okay, so a brief intro about custom engine agents after declarative agents is that I'm pretty sure some of you already experimented a lot with bots before. It was pretty popular back in the days with Teams integrations as well. And today we are actually calling a new form of custom integrations in the chat environment, and we call them custom engine agents. And today we are able to use custom engine agents in Teams, Outlook, and Microsoft 365 spaces. You can imagine custom engine agents more like a custom bot, but with more Copilot capabilities. You're using a special SDK to create custom engine agents, which is called Teams AI Library. And Teams AI Library has all these goodies where we can make our agent look more like Copilot, and we can give the Copilot look and feel to our experience, as well as we can also use any model we want from, basically we call here Azure AI services, but you can also use model outside of the Azure AI library. You can pretty much integrate with any data source you want. So this is kind of a custom architecture we bring in a table. If you need to, let's say, build your own orchestrator, use your own model, and also bring any data point you want, any search experience you want, such as semantic, vector, hybrid, all sorts of capabilities you can add in the custom environment, you can use custom engine agents. So the good thing about Teams AI Library is that, and I'm going to move one slide further to explain this, we can bring our existing bots as custom engine agents, and we can use them in Microsoft 365, but they will also use custom large language models or small language models behind the scene. They will use your orchestrator of your choice. On top of that, with Teams AI Library, we'll be able to add some of the UI components that any Copilot agent would need. And there are also more features coming at Ignite, so I highly recommend you to catch up with Ignite news as well. So just to give you a little bit of idea how custom engine agents would look like, I have a really short demo. You can imagine this demo more of a, you know, trade research company needed a career expert. And we actually built a custom engine agent called Career Genie to help get, basically find the right candidates for the positions we need. So Career Genie has a bunch of capabilities we integrated using Teams AI library, and we are using custom language model behind the scene, which is GPT-4, and we are also using our own orchestrator behind the scene with the integration of Azure AI search. We are leveraging vector search with our data set with a bunch of CVs available behind the scene as well. Okay, let's see how it looks like. So, just to start, Career Genie works on Teams, and we can basically ask questions to Career Genie, and you will see that it is friendly and it can help you anything related to career. You will see some of the components, UI components here as AI generated. We can see feedback loop integrated, and we can provide feedback as a user, and we can submit them. So we can also ask questions like, can you suggest me .NET developers who can speak Spanish, for example? And our data set is available with a lot of CVs, resumes, and Career Genie will suggest us a couple of candidates which are more convenient to this position. In addition to all of this, we can also integrate with authentication. So we're using SSO here in Career Genie. We can also ask more complex questions such as, can you suggest candidates and add candidates in, let's say, .NET developer candidates list? Career Genie is able to create lists for us, and it can add the candidates we want. We can also ask add Anthony in the same list with Isaac. We don't have to mention with which list, for example. This is all the greatness of LLMs, SLMs, and we can create more lists, and we can delete lists. We can basically do any action we want with Career Genie at this point. So in this case, Career Genie is able to create and remember multiple lists for us. In addition to all of the UI capabilities we can add, such as AI-generated, security label, thumbs up, thumbs down, etc. And it can also handle other complex queries. And after all these, you know, creating lists, we can send the list to HR using Microsoft Graph. And if you go ahead and check our Outlook, we will see the same list appear and sent to our HR for scheduling interviews as well. So this all is a really short demo, but in the complex architectures where we would require more complex integrations with Azure AI search, where we would need more custom models using multimodal maybe behind the scene. These kind of architectures are pretty helpful. And you can actually find this resource to build your own Career Genie in Copilot Camp. I really want to jump to the next slide. Bob, if you want to add something here, please jump in. But with all these demos we've shown today, Bob and I, they're all available in Copilot Camp, actually. If you go to Copilot Camp, you will see two different paths. One is build, another one is extend. And in the extend path, you will be able to see the declarative agents that Bob showed you earlier. And in the build path, you'll be able to see Career Genie, and you can actually build your own Career Genie just following this path. And in Copilot Camp, you can also find a bunch of YouTube videos to help you through, along with the lab materials. And that's probably all I can say. Bob, do you want to add anything on top of this? Wait, I can't hear Bob.
I worked on the extend path, which is the one on the left there with declarative agents. I really had fun. I should just following your labs and testing them out and building my own agents. So I think it's not only educational, but if maybe you have to be a, you know, kind of into this, but I thought it was really fun to see the thing come to life.
Yeah, same with the extend pad. I built the build path, but I pretty enjoyed the extend path as well when I was following all the labs and building a declarative agent from scratch. And there is also a really fun declarative agent at the beginning to get started. I'm pretty sure you will all really enjoy both paths. If you have time, you can also leave feedback to our GitHub repository as well. So in addition to this, and maybe if we have time at the end, Bob, you can walk us through how the Copilot camp looks like. But before we close out, I really want to announce our upcoming event, which is the most exciting thing coming up in November 7th. So we are actually having a live one-hour event focusing on Copilot agents. It's called Microsoft 365 Copilot Developer Camp. And you can join this one-hour event to basically have fun. You will see games, doodles, interviews. You'll see Donna Sarkar there doing the interviews in studio. You'll also see a bunch of panel interviews, and we will have sessions dedicated to declarative agents, custom engine agents. We really suggest you to check out ak.ms/copilotdevcamp/live, where you will be directed to our Copilot Camp Developer Camp event, basically the event page. That's all I wanted to cover today. I feel like we have maybe 2-3 minutes left, Bob, if you want to go through the Copilot camp.
Sure. I mean, you did a great job. I don't have too much to add. If you want, I can show the website briefly. But and there's a few questions in the chat as well. So
sure,
you can take a look at those. But this is the site. If you go to this is not the live event site. This is the Copilot Developer Camp. A good place to start is this is right here. This is the September 16th announcement. And then we've got video briefings on the kind of one on how to choose or what are the agents themselves, and then custom engine agents, declarative agents, API, hands-on labs. Here's all those hands-on labs. And then more videos, including Doodle to Code. And so Tomomi will be on the live cast as well, doing some architectural doodles that only she can do. And then there's Copilot Camp in a Box. So this is kind of cool. If you want to share this in your community, we've actually built all the PowerPoint decks. So a keynote and then one on DAs, declarative agents, and one on custom engine agents. And these even include video demos. So if you want to kind of make, you know, push the easy button on it, you can use our demos, or you can, I would encourage you to do the labs anyway, so you really understand it, but, and maybe then you decide to do it live. And then there's decks for sharing that are smaller because the demo ones are rather large. We have some conversations set up in GitHub, and then we're also, my team, actually Waldeck Mastercards and Gary Trinder are working on Microsoft Learn modules. And I think, I don't know if you might also be involved in that, Ayça, I'm not sure. But there are Learn modules now for extending Copilot. And we're linking to those as well. So there's more material there. And then issues. So everything is, this is just GitHub. This whole thing is built in GitHub. This whole thing is open source. So if you click there, you end up in the Copilot Camp repo. We do accept pull requests. We do look at the issues. We have the discussions here. There's a wiki. So the idea is that we're working in the open, and everything we're doing is open source. And we would love if you checked it out and maybe participate. So that's all I can think of to say right now. I should join next week and go a little deeper on declarative agents.
Excellent. Thank you, Bob and Ayça. Watching under the time, that gives me 2 minutes of closing up the call on time. But thank you, Ayça. Thank you, Bob. Really cool stuff. I went through all of that material pretty recently. Also, the Copilot Camp in a Box. The presentations are really, really good. So awesome stuff there. Videos are great. If anybody wants to show how it's intended to actually work, all of that is included there, like Bob was saying. So super, super, super valuable stuff. If you're an MCT, as in Microsoft Certified Trainer, you can download the box and start delivering the training material and trainings within your regional area. And that's really the idea of the Copilot Camp within a Box as well. So scale around the world. That's great work. Awesome stuff. Now, thank you, Cathy. Thank you, Ayça. Thank you, Bob. Great demos today. It was good that we only had two demos today. That was intentional as well, so we don't get to rush on topics. Unfortunately, next week we do have three demos. So there's a lot of demand for these demo slots, but that means that there's a bit of a shorter time for every single demo. It is what it is. We'll adjust based on the slots and timings. Now, today, next week, as mentioned, three different demos. We're going to talk about AI 0-1, building an AI field company communicator author app experience using Azure OpenAI. Then Steve Busalik will be joining us on building a SharePoint embedded center of excellence solution with Power Platform. It's a really cool app, which is a Power Apps app, which is then using the SharePoint embedded behind the scenes. And then Bob is going to hear to talking about building declarative agents with API plugins next week. Really, really cool stuff on next Tuesday. Now, in the meanwhile, please join on all of the different community channels what we have available. One of them is relatively new, which is the Discord channel. We have more than 2,300 members there already asking questions and helping everybody else within the community. Great option if you are active in the Discord as well. Now, we're always looking for feedback around these calls. So what works, what doesn't work, which you would like to see, please do fill in the form every now and then, even though you have done it in the past as well. That helps on keeping these calls running because we can show current evaluations on the calls within our leadership. So if people like the calls, we keep on doing them. If the people don't like the calls, then we're not going to keep on doing them. Right now, the feedback is great. So thank you for that one as well. Now, this recording will be available within 24 hours at Microsoft Community Learning YouTube channel at AKMS Community YouTube. Subscribe today. You will get notified when it's actually available there. It will be typically faster than 24 hours. Again, 24 hours gives us some flexibility on processing the videos. Follow us on LinkedIn or in a Twitter to get notified on when the stuff is getting released. And the next call is on 27th at 8 a.m. Pacific time. And by the way, again, 28th next week, the time zones will be a bit off for Europe. So you might be impacted. US moves to normal time, so to say, from summertime. So it might actually switch the hours, the call timing a bit for you. So double check the timing. If you have downloaded the recurrent invite, it will adjust itself automatically. If you're based in US, you will not notice this change at all. So it will be normal next week as well. But thanks everybody for joining. Awesome call. And we'll be back within later this week on the course and also next week on 29th of October. Thanks everybody. Let's stay in touch. Bye-bye.